Pada pagi hari ini kita dapat berkumpul di sini untuk melaksanakan workshop konservasi perspektif lukisan yang diselenggarakan atas kerjasama jurusan Arkeologi Fakultas Ilmu Budaya UGM dan Dinas Budaya Provinsi.
Akan saya memberikan sedikit riwayat mengapa kita mengadakan workshop ini. Jadi kita memiliki banyak sekali heritage di wilayah Yogyakarta, banyak sekali memiliki warisan budaya, tetapi masih sedikit terpikir di kepala kita bahwa lukisan itu juga menjadi heritage. Ya. Dengan bertambahnya usia lukisan, dengan pentingnya beberapa nilai penting lukisan, lukisan itu juga menjadi heritage yang penting bagi Indonesia. Dan kita juga tiba-tiba tergagap-gagap menyadari bahwa sangat sedikit konservator lukisan.
It was an international definition which was adopted at a conference in Delhi in 2008, because what was happening in the cultural heritage world is that everybody was using different terms talking about preventive conservation. Am I talking loud enough? So, preventive conservation, that's all measures and actions aimed at avoiding and minimizing future deterioration or loss. They're carried out within the context or the surroundings of an item, or often of a group of items, whatever their age and condition. These measures are indirect and they do not interfere with the material and structure of the items, and they do not modify their appearance. So examples are environmental control, handling, packing, storage, all the physical aspects of exhibition management, security. There are an enormous amount of things which can be done within preventive conservation. But I'm sure you all know this. Make a quick diagram of what it looks like. So the most important factor within conservation, taken as a general word, is preventive conservation. Coming down to remedial conservation, that is actually hands-on work, that is the least important. It's the last resort, because it most probably means that you have done something wrong at this level. So this is why remedial conservation is the last resort. Restoration comes further, it's most probably not the first priority, because you want to save, you want to avoid deterioration of collections, paintings collections. And it's only if you have time and if you have the opportunity that you will most probably get down to the aesthetics, to the restoration, removing varnish and that sort of thing. New ideas about within the different bands of preventive conservation, objects, preventive conservation, legal, of what you have to take care of. What does preventive conservation do? It just defers and reduces the need for remedial conservation. It's important to have a written preventive conservation policy within your institution. It gives you a founding, it gives you something which you can refer back to. Financing also is very important, to reserve some money for preventive within the institution. The most difficult is actually implementing it. That means putting it into practice on an everyday basis. Staff training is necessary. Keeping, management, how often do you clean your museums, with what they've done, like for example, I read some articles that some rooms are Vietnam, I think it was, were cleaned with enormous amount of water, so the relative humidity went even higher than what it was already. And I'm sure you all know that dust, if you have dust and humidity, attracts mold. And this is really a particular problem in a country like Indonesia. Appropriate environment for paintings and making sure that the environment is monitored. I'm sure you're all thinking, well, this is practically impossible in Indonesia with a tropical climate that we have, and actually it is a very, it's a big challenge here, I can see that. Mm. But, as you know, the hotter the temperature, the faster the degradation of your materials will be. They can survive the longest between about 45 and 65. I'm saying this for a country like Indonesia. In Europe, the margin is very much smaller. Above 65 degrees, you'll get mold and your bacteria. So it is a very difficult situation, but I think there are solutions, and they lie in the passive, in the preventive environment, the passive environmental control, which are relatively expensive, like don't even consider air conditioning, but open your doors, put forced ventilation. It will help to prevent mold growth, and don't shut in your paintings behind glass, and maybe try to get them away from the wall. Researched and supported also by the Getty and the University of Canberra in Australia, where there's a lot of research being done. The challenge is that if you open your windows and you force your ventilation, there could be pollutants coming in, and there is still ongoing research there to see how you can reduce that. Saying that in one go. It's an ongoing field, there's always research going on. Paintings are complex creatures. They are made up of enormous amount of layers, and they're very, very sensitive to the environment. Now you might think, why are they? Because if you have a layered structure, it makes it very sensitive, because all the different layers will react differently to the environment. It's not like having one piece of wood which will react in one way. This you have a layered where they're all reacting in different ways. They're unique, and this contributes to their importance on the cultural value level. It makes them very important in a collection. This is a diagram, a very simple diagram of how a painting can be made. I mean, the amount of materials which can be used in a painting are so enormous that you can't make a diagram for all the paintings. It's just to give an example. This is a typical build-up of how a painting on canvas is made. So this signifies the canvas. On top of the canvas, there will be a glue layer, which most probably is used to shut the canvas so that when you're using oil, the oil won't go straight through. On top of the glue layer, you will have a chalk layer, a brown layer. A brown layer is a mixture of chalk with animal glue. Sometimes they have added oil, which is not a very good idea because it creates problems in the future with paint coming up. Sometimes you have an imprimatur layer, that's another glue layer which is on top of the ground. Then comes the paint, and sometimes you have a varnish and sometimes you don't. I'll give you another, hang on, this is another diagram to try to make it look more visual. This is the stretcher. So that is where the canvas is pulled onto. Then you have the canvas, you have the ground. You can have a colored layer also sometimes on the ground. Then you have your paint layer and then varnish. But this is just one example. Here you can see that I have a canvas and a panel, and yet again, the build-up will be different. It's unpredictable. You never know exactly how a painting has been built, unless you're the artist yourself. So very often you will need to do some scientific research to understand what you're doing as a conservator. I put this up because I couldn't make you a list of all the materials which are made, which paintings are made from. They're enormous quantities. But coming back to this, I'm going to talk now about preventive conservation guidelines which you could actually use on your objects. I was talking beforehand about the general ones, now more on the specific possibilities. Making pads to protect your works. Making this sort of thing, which is rather interesting. This is a system actually to make, if you have very, very big cases, is to get them up safely without the case falling down. What I mentioned before is also training and handling, what is not good. For example, this one, if you take your painting by the top of your frame and the frame is not stable, it will just fall. This one is also not good because you're not looking at your painting, you don't know what's happening. And not wearing these sort of things. There's an example for big paintings. Don't try to handle the big painting alone. So I'm going to go through this one. You'll get the printout. This is just something which maybe you can take into your policies and write them down. Transport frames. This is another interesting phenomenon. It's that, for example, in the Stedelijk Museum, we have two buildings. We have the museum building and the storage building. But if we would have to make cases for every painting that went to the museum building, it would cost too much. So there has been a transport frame, which is just a frame like this, which is in which the painting is hung. So you can just cover it and transport it climatized, so it's put into a truck. And we hang them also with the transport frame in the storage. So that means that we're minimizing direct contact with the artwork. Especially with a modern art collection, this is very important also for an old art, but modern art very often there's not a frame. And if you have a very light surface, if you touch it too much, you will create fingerprints. Well, you'll create pressure more by every time you pick it up. So it's a good solution. It's once you have it, it stays with the work, and you can hang it, and it will go all over the place with it. And you can put it into a bigger case if it's going by plane.
Okay, what material can you use for the
use wood, but it's popular wood and it has been insect controlled. I imagine that in Indonesia you may have to use another. We use popular multiplex because it's not too heavy. And I don't know in Indonesia which type of woods you have here, except for teak, but teak would be too heavy. One particular painting, normally we put hardware at the back of the painting to hang in, but for this one it was not possible, so we had to actually make a sandwich in the frame, and this is just a protection with Tyvek to make sure that it doesn't work. Dusting, this is also something which can be done with a preventive conservation. In order to be able to dust, you also have to first know how to look. That's why examination is so important. Because if there is a loose piece of paint and you just go like this and you fall off, so you have to look before.
How to use that safely to clean the painting?
A very soft brush. Don't clean, dust. There's a difference between dusting and cleaning. What can happen if your painting is badly framed? I don't know whether you can see this. This was a painting I had at home and it had a rusted nail, so it had moved in the frame and it made dents. And because it had moved on the frame, it had taken the paint off the sides. So framing is yet another preventive conservation measure. Bit more close to the object than the general, but this is also something a lot of people, museum personnel, could do if they were just trained properly and using the right hardware. Here's an example, appropriate framing hardware. This is the cross-section of a frame, and this is a framing system in metal with a little pad underneath so that the painting is kept in the frame. So this is the frame rebate. Now it's important when you have a frame rebate, this is this part here of the frame, that it's protected so that if it does rub, that it doesn't create any scratches or damages.
Jadi Bapak Ibu sekarang sangat penting untuk memberikan tag pada tulisannya. Dan ini adalah bagian teknik yang bisa digunakan untuk memberikan pemahaman pada tulisan dan bentuk frame.
This is an example of a frame of a painting which has been framed reasonably well. Because there was so much space in the frame, there's been balsa wood which has been added, and then the strips which have been placed afterwards. In this case, we avoided to use holes in the stretcher because it's a historic stretcher. It's also important to remember that when you're doing this sort of thing, they're very often at the back of paintings and at the back of frames. There are historical labels, and you don't want to damage those. So you have to really make sure you're putting your framing system at the right spot. Inadequate hanging systems, well, they can break, and then your painting will fall on the ground. It's also not good for your frame. It's better to actually have always 2 points to hang your painting. It's also very handy if there are earthquakes as well. I know the, in Los Angeles where there's an earthquake, so they have everything on little springs and 2 points. I don't know, I think there's some earthquakes here sometimes.
Yeah, very often.
Yeah.
Jadi perlu juga mengetahui cara menggantung lukisan, cara memasang lukisan dengan dua string itu jauh lebih aman, terutama untuk daerah-daerah yang banyak gempa seperti Indonesia. Harus diberikan bentuk supaya kalau ada gerakan itu
bisa this is the kind of box, yet again something which I doubt, I'm not sure, this would really be, need to be researched here if that would be useful. In a climber box you just shut your whole painting in and you use the capacity of the stretcher or the panel to regulate the climate within a closed environment. But as here the environment is so humid, I think this would only cause more problems, especially after what we saw in the museum in Prato yesterday, where the paintings, enormous paintings, are behind glass and there's mold or a hole inside of the glass. And the other point with the glass is that you can't see the paintings because they reflect. But most important is that the mold is, the spring is eating up paint and canvas and glue there. So, what will I be talking about? I will be talking within the next few days when we'll be talking about the red and the orange. But I thought it would be unfair if I didn't say why I wasn't talking about the other, the ochre and the light yellow. Here's a definition of remedial conservation, which Alian was giving earlier on. So that's maybe you want to translate it directly, or not all actions directly.
Well, actually, they already know.
Yes, you already know this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just general idea, not for painting, but for
all kinds. I say remedial conservation should only be carried out by a trained conservator. It's needed if the object has. It's made in such a way that it's not stable. Or if an object is so fragile that any preventive conservation would not help anymore. For example, flaking paint. I've put some examples up for you, for examples of remedial conservation, the same every time. This is really something that a trained conservator should do. You must probably ask yourself, why? Well, for example, you have to go to structure. You have to be able to analyze what you're doing, what type of glue you're using. And we had a discussion about this yesterday, is that the use of blues in tropical climates is not a simple matter. There's a very well-known blue which has been used in conservation since the 1970s called paraloid, but apparently in tropical climates it will melt. So a conservator will need to do research. You have to be able to look into different possibilities and be able to know where to test things. Look at paraloid. It's not to be used here. Another example is repairing tears. Now, what you don't want is people sticking patches at the back of your paint, or cutting out something where the paint has fallen off or is not very stable, and they thought, oh, we'll cut it out and we'll stick something behind. It needs quite a lot of manual dexterity and also knowledge of what you're doing to repair tears. And the techniques are becoming more and more defined. You can see here, there was an example. I think this one is about in human, from the same thing, where a whole new system was developed with a surgical deal to actually repair the tears. So all that, what that means, it's more an aesthetical treatment. It is also sometimes combined with technical art history, where you're actually doing scientific research in order to see how the paint was originally, how it was built up. Yet again, trained conservators should carry this out. This is an example of restoration of a village panel. You can see what I've seen some very often in places where restoration carried out by non-conservators or people without knowledge of the paint layers, that I mean the canvas or the wood would be seen and just filling with paint where it was, so it remains visible, whilst you have to build up your restoration, your treatment in this similar way as the original, never using actually the same materials also, because you have to remain stay reversible. That's one of the principles. That reversible means that you can take it off again. Sorry, because this is lasting too long. So, firstly, preventive conservation comes first. Conservators are trained professionals, so there's a lot of things that can be done on this part, and we leave this part to a professional. So what are we going to be talking about today? What are we going to be doing? Well, I'm very, very curious to know how the situation is in your institutions, so that we can discuss, are there any strategies to make it even better? And what can't be done, and what can be done in Indonesia? I'm not always aware of the context, so I'm very interested to hear from you what you know and what you have experienced.